So this is from my lecture. I kind of reduce it to as a minimum as possible to explain what is going on and why is magnetic material is very important. I kind of show that comparison, in a way, there is a certain duality. And when you think about magnetics, you can make comparison with what existed before. You have DC source and you have a resistor. So you have voltage source driving it in a resistor, and you have constant current and constant voltage. Now, what is equivalent to the magnetic circuit? Well, you have a ampere turn excitation. So really, the current is the one which drives the core flux around the core. And the core equivalent to resistance, it is this symbol that I call reluctance, is the reluctance which is equivalent to resistor. And when you talk about current and voltage, you have that the current is proportional to the voltage, and coefficient proportionality is conductance, which is in Siemens, and resistance is in ohms. So that was prior to Tesla, prior to Faraday, and then Tesla and AC. Now, when we have here, we think about this, this NI, I is a time-varying current, even though I put it constant, time-varying current. And then you have ampere turns driving the flux in the core, and reluctance is proportionality, like here, conductance. So that is what it is. Now, what about a current distribution? You drive it with a voltage source, you look at the current distribution, and you find out, okay, what is in each branch. Well, the same thing in a magnetic core. You can have a different structure. You can have a, you know, ampere turns driving it on one leg, and then you look at the distribution of fluxes. And then flux distribution, just like amperes, just like Kirchhoff's laws for this, the equivalent laws hold for a magnetic circuit. Because why? Here, you look at the driving source, you look at the flux distribution, and how do you find distribution? You look, you know, the equations, loop and node equations. Well, you can do the same thing here. You have a loop and node equation. And this node, flux coming in has to be equal to sum of two fluxes coming out. So it's equivalent to the current distribution in this circuit. And what about the voltage, loop equation? To summarize that, the drops around the loop are equal. Well, the same thing holds here. You know, you look at the fluxes times the reluctances of each branch plus the driving source, that is an equation. So you can use now this equation to solve flux distribution in any magnetic circuit, okay? And of course, current limitation, you can put a lot of current in high current density in a small piece of wire. The problem is in the magnetics, you do have a limitation that a core material can have only so much density, and density is described in flux density described in Tesla. The best materials nowadays can go up to 1.6 Tesla, but the ferrite materials can go only to 0.3 Tesla, flux density unidirectional. And then what's the problem? The problem to understand magnetics is because for electrical circuit, you have a current probe and you can measure current in any branch, and that way find the distribution, find the time domain current in any branch and so on. But what you need for magnetics to understand what is going on, you need to have a special device which is going to be able to look at the flux. So you have a here flux. And how do you do that? Well, it's very simple. You use a simple single winding, and a single winding by Faraday's law, NdV per dt, will create a voltage. And you take this voltage and integrate it over time, and you get a flux as a function of time. And then you measure the current on this resistor, and you get a current as a function of time. So the point is, you have on one scope, you can have a flux and a current as a function of time and driving voltage. And on the other scope, you can put them in XY coordinates, and which will be flux versus current versus flux versus current, which eventually will result in a so-called BH loop. And what are the quantities which we deal with? Electric field intensity and current density, and equivalent is magnetic field intensity, which is and flux density. And, you know, equivalent laws are current density is proportional to conduction time electric field, and flux density is, this is the famous constant. You know why it's important? Because B is mu zero H. And this says the flux is proportional in the air to mu zero, which is permeability of free space, which is very small, 4 pi 10 to minus 7 henries per meter. And there is equivalent sigma zero, which is epsilon zero, which is for capacitors for the electric field. And Faraday actually came up with his beautiful theory and this famous equation, which we found out that the B and H cannot, you know, exist in current electrical field and magnetic field. They exist at the same time. There cannot be electric field without magnetic field, and the other end of case propagate with a B times electromagnetic field propagate like two vectors and pointing vectors. And in fact, he came up with his famous prediction, which he didn't actually realize, that the electromagnetic waves are, they're not only light, but also all electromagnetic waves have the same speed, which is 1/√ and epsilon times mu zero, and which is about 300,000 kilometers per second. And that was true for visible light, but it's true also for all the other electromagnetic waves spectrum. So that was, you know, the confirmation of that theory. And, you know, you can go through this Ampere's circuit law and Faraday's law, but ultimately what is important is using this law in a very simple geometry. What I just showed you with the Ørsted law is Ørsted law, it says the current here will create a radius distance R H field, because remember, H, the current is the source of the magnetic flux intensity vector H, and it's tangent to this. And you can, you, on this geometry, you can find out that this H times L, H times length of this, and the length of this is 2 pi R. So you find that H field and this distance here is exactly that force which would be exerted. In fact, when you multiply it in mu zero, there is exerted the force which will go on that magnetic needle according to Ørsted law. And the beauty of all magnetics is what they didn't realize at the time, including the Faraday and so on, they all were not, even though he made a transformer, but he tried to use to make a DC generator. So they used only one turn because it was there was no use of the flux. But once you have a structure like a toroid and you put a number of turns on it, number of windings on it, the flux in the core is one, but the flux seen by the end of windings is multiplied by the number of turns. So if the number of turns is n, the flux is n times flux in a core. So this is called the flux linkages or lambda. It's number of turns times the flux. So it is dramatically increased, the flux by number of turns. So it's a multiplying factor. And of course, here are these units for meter, kilogram, second, and ampere, international system of units. And the unit for H field is ampere per meter, or in Gauss system is Ørsted, which is, you know, not practical, you know, but physicists use it. But the MKSA system uses Tesla for flux density. And in the Gauss system, it's Gauss, which is 10 to minus 4 Tesla. And of course, the problem is with this physicist that use is mu zero is 1 Gauss over Ørsted, whereas in a physical AC system, it's 4 pi 10 to minus 7 henries per meter, which is a permeability, fixed permeability given in an MKSA system. Now comes the important thing, which I want you to really comprehend. And that is, when we have this field, H field, remember, the current is drives the flux in a coil and is proportional. And then once you have this flux, then the flux density is B0 mu times H. So what I'm trying to prove here is that flux density increases with the mu zero, which is very small. So if you have a coil and no magnetic material in it, it is it can take a long time to get some decent flux density, but on the other hand, it'll never saturate. That's a big advantage of the air core, because you can put make one Tesla. In fact, that's what they're doing. When they make this superconducting coil, they can put a lot of current, because they needed to get one or two Tesla flux density for containing the plasma, for example, fusion reactors and so on. But then we can use a big advantage that if you go to from that, and now if you increase, that's what's happening in the air. But once we put a magnetic material, this is where the beauty comes. There are three magnetic material, three elements, nickel, cobalt, and iron, which are so-called ferromagnetic. They have a property that they have a large number of magnetic domains. What it means, their magnetic domains are tied to the outermost electron on orbit of that particular atom. And this is very loosely coupled, because it's on an outer shell, to the to the, you know, the you know, neutron and protons in the center. So therefore, it takes very little energy to reorient them in a direction of external field. So once you put a current through here, you are generating external field in this direction. If it is zero current, there is a zero external force, and then all these domains are randomly oriented, and ferromagnetic material in itself is not magnetic, and it doesn't exhibit any properties unless you start exciting it. And that's the whole point. Once you start exciting it, even with a minute current, which is, remember, this H is proportional to current. So the small current will create a huge flux density. In fact, this is represented with the relative permeability of magnetic material, which can be, for a silicon steel, 100,000. So that means if you have just a coil with a certain cross section, if you put a ferromagnetic material in it, you have 100,000 times higher slope. What does it mean? That means that you have a huge inductance for that transformer, which means you have a small magnetizing current, which has everything going and no energy storage, and it's all transfer from a huge amount of power instantaneously from input to output. In fact, it is transferring by speed of light, really. So that's one thing. So this is one property, which is high flux density, which makes it much more useful. And if you go and orient to some of them, then you have this increased. But the problem is, once you have once you reach a certain peak current, and you basically physically oriented all magnetic domains in external direction, so what happens? The core is then saturated, and any further increase of the flux, it only comes due to extra current. So you can see this is where this magnetic structure, this inductance or transformer, has this abrupt saturation, relatively abrupt. So the huge inductance, 100 times 1,000, becomes just inductance in the air. And of course, if you make a transformer which goes into this saturation, it's disaster, because that is actually short, like putting short on a transformer secondary. You have a huge current and blow up everything, right? So that's one nuisance that exists in the transformers. You can get a huge inductance, but you got to be careful not to saturate the core, right? So now there is another problem with it. And as my demonstration showed, you can look at my YouTube demonstration of it and post it also, and you will get it posted when you join for a course. You'll get it posted on my box folder, a cloud for storage for all attendees. If you increase there are two types of magnetic materials. Those which have very abrupt saturation, so typically those with a high voltage, a high flux density silicon steel and low frequency material, they give high saturation up to 1.6 Tesla. Those which are used in the higher frequencies like ferrite, they have typically 0.3 Tesla. Now, most of the material now go to half a Tesla, 0.6 Tesla maximum in both direction. And these are ferrite manganese zinc alloys, and they're called linear material, and these are, you know, square root material. But, and here is what I just mentioned before, there are only three element in the nature which you can dig out of the earth and purify it, which is iron, cobalt, and nickel, which are ferromagnetic, and they have these flux densities. But there are many man-made material combining this different addition to ferrite, for example, 3% silicon adding to the iron will make it this flux density. But if you look at some of these magnetic materials like permandur, which is used in the military, 50% cobalt and 50% ferrite, you know, alloy, look at this property. It has 2.45 flux density, bigger than either one of them, which kind of gave us hope maybe we can synthesize better material, because higher flux density means that the magnetic structure will proportionally be smaller. Okay, enough for that. So now, what about this here? And this shows the actual practical flux densities of different material, all right? And here you see the high flux density material, magnesyl, ortonol, whatever is the technical names, permalloy used in military, you know, ferrite. And ferrite is mainly what is used for anything above a few kilohertz, okay? And so now you can get, now this is important part I want to impress on you. You have electric current and you have copper. And when you drive the voltage, you basically contain all the current in the copper, because the resistance of the rest of it is so much higher, so that all the current is really contained in this path. Well, for a magnetic circuit, if you drive it with the winding and you have a ferromagnetic material, yes, you have some leakages, but basically most of the flux is really forced to go through this low reluctance flux path, you know. And you can then make this, reluctance concept to come up with a resistance, which is length of the copper divided by conductivity of the copper and cross section. But what's analogous for a magnetic circuit is the so-called reluctance, that is the length of magnetic material in the center of the core divided by permeability of the core and cross section. You see the similarity, identical, right? So given Ni, you can find the flux, all right. Now, given that, I want to impress you another thing. The big thing, a big misunderstanding in the magnetics, incomplete, is physicists claim their own Gauss laws and their own equations and so on, and assign a certain magic to B versus H and say, oh, now H and B, and I can't go into detail, but you know, there's so many, even, you know, Professor Emeritus, which claim out, oh, this is such a fantastic, you put an air gap in a magnetic material and you have this magic that it can now take a much higher current. Well, it's a nonsense. You know, why this nonsense? Because they don't understand one thing. B versus H is a property, point property of magnetic materials. Flux density versus field intensity. As I explained, there are different type of materials. But for a one material, might be 100,000, this slope. And for others, ferrite might be 5,000 or 10,000. In any case, that is a property of material. However, what we have to deal with is we don't care, we want to transfer the point property of a material, typical material, we want to transfer it into integral property. So once you have a sample, and a sample of core, say toroid is typical structure to think about, you have a certain length of magnetic path in the center and certain cross section, okay? And then if you go in a previous one that I just showed you, if you go with versus way versus H, this is material property. But now if we go and apply it to particular core with its own geometry, cross section and the length, what happens? My B versus H, I'm going to convert it vertical coordinate. I'm going to simply, where it was B, multiply the cross section of the sample. And what I get? I get a flux in the core, right? In Weber's. And what I look at the horizontal coordinate, I'm going to multiply whatever H field is of magnetic material, I'm going to multiply it with the length of that core. So I'm bringing geometry of the core into the picture and slowly introducing the concept of inductance. So now this characteristic of magnetic material becomes a device characteristic of the flux in this core as a function of ampere turns. And the slope of that is permanence. I just introduced to you what a notion of permanence is, inductance per single turn. And then we go one more step and introduce a number of turns. Now, remember, we now take about another concept, which is the flux linkages. There is one flux in the core, which is unique for that core. And if I put a number of turns, there is a total number of turns, and then a total flux showing, looking from a standpoint of the terminal of the device, is number of turns times flux. Now, like anything in engineering, you can make it useless. What will happen if half of a turns you wind in one direction and the other half of a turn you forget to count the clockwise and you start working counterclockwise? What are you going to get? You get a zero flux. So you can make a useless, stupid device, just don't know what you're doing, right? So, but the point is, let's say we are trying to do large inductance, therefore putting it all in the same term. So what happens with my characteristic? My characteristic changes from flux linkages, from flux to ampere turns, a characteristic. I multiply vertical coordinate with the number of turns I used in this device, and divide this horizontal coordinates by number of turns. Of course, what's going to happen with this slope? It's going to increase with the number of turns squared. Multiply one and divide the other one, so the slope is going to go n squared times that. Of course, n squared times permanence. So that's what you say. Permanence is inductance per single turn, and times the number of squared, you get a huge increase of inductance. That's the whole point of an AC inductor. That's the whole point of a transformer, to have AC inductor and as much as big as you can inductance, okay? So, and what is now lambda versus current? Lambda is flux linkages, and current is a horizontal coordinate. What is the slope? Slope is in inductance, you see? So now we came from discussing this like a physicist, B versus H, and how the magic of H does allow the large DC current in it. This is nonsense. What we are doing is we're showing that inductance of AC inductor is huge because we don't have air gap. And precisely my demonstration now here, yeah, and here is the essence of my understanding. Remember I said difficult understanding magnetics, you have to be able to look at it. So what I have is I have sample set up a special BH loop tester, which I can use, core, which I drive here, with a square wave voltage or sine wave, whatever. And I put a one turn sense winding and then use a voltage induced on it, integrate it all with, and I get a flux. And then I multiply the number of turns of this sample and then get the flux density and divide by, then I get flux density B versus H, so I get, if I put a one coordinate versus the other, I get B versus H. On another scope, I can put a voltage driven and a current resulting and a flux resulting. So you can have two different scopes showing this, what is going on. Okay, so that's BH loop tester, which you made. Normally you won't find it, you cannot buy it except for 60 Hertz, but we made one which was from 10 kilohertz to 1 megahertz with a square wave drive. So we can really look what's happening in magnetic circuits. And that's how my demonstrations were derived using that. Okay.